You're welcome back to Channel Sport this morning. Time to review what went down in Algeria yesterday between U.S. and Algeria and defending league champions Plateau United in the CAF Confederation Cup. In case you missed it, that result wasn't favorable at all for the Nigerian side. They lost by 4 goals, 2-0. And as a result, they're out of the CAF Confederation Cup. They will not make it to the group stage because eventually it was 5-2. On aggregate. And yeah, Karadi, I mean, we started from the first leg. 2-1 is a very slim win to take to a hostile territory like Algeria. And no surprises at all that Plateau United, it's the end of the road for them.
Yeah, the outstar wasn't unexpected. In my opinion, they were dead men walking. Having won by 2-1. Mm. And the away side scoring a vital goal on the road. And knowing that you're going to an environment where antics, shenanigans, and what have you are the order of the day.
And very good it players
was,
as well.
It was definitely going to be difficult for Plateau United. They stood firm against early pressure.
Yeah.
But they buckled against the pressure eventually in the 29th minute. But I was a bit concerned because 3 out of the 4 goals they conceded came from set-piece situations, especially from corner kicks. 2 were from headers, and I was wondering, this should have been envisaged and planned towards. Elisha Gobe, the captain of the side, who is also a center half, tried the best he could, but their best just wasn't good enough. I guess the occasion was just too big for them to handle, and eventually they lost down by 4-0. Do not forget that they also lost 4-2.
Yeah,
to Etoile du Sahel.
That was a much better
African side.
That was a much better performance than this.
A much better performance. And if you have players like Akingo Sanga, who's played on the continent with other club sides, and other players as well, like Rafael Ayagua, Tosin Omoyele, and even Elisha Gobe, and Dele Ajibwe, who even saved us a number of times in that encounter, you'll be saying maybe they should have done better than they did. But right about now, they are out. They'll need to focus on the NPFL and
it brings us back to this. I know there won't be time to trash out all the issues. Are we ready? Because I don't think we can continue seeing, even as a fan, not as a journalist, my heart bleeds anytime we're going to North Africa because I know it's going to be a trailer load of goals. And you begin to ask, CAF might just slash our slots anytime soon. I mean, this kind of performances, then you ask yourself, aside Enyimba, do you have any club? Any club side in Nigeria, you could beat your chest and say, these guys will go on the continent even when they lose. It will be scandalous.
Well, quite frankly, we are not ready. But when Enyimba won it for the first time in 2003, we weren't ready as well. But the then governor splashed funds, bought the best of players. Recall they lost scandalously to Inter Milan at some point, given the needed exposure. But the fact that majority of our teams are dependent on states, funds are not released as and when due. So it affects the plans of the team, even if it's pristine on paper. But execution could be an issue. We need to recruit even better players if we really want to stake a claim on the continent. Because the last time we had the team as far as the semifinals of the CAF Champions League and the Confederations Cup was Sunshine Stars in 2012 and in 2013 under Bingo Gubote. Yes, Rivers United got to the group stage of the CAF Confederations Cup last year, but it was nothing to write him about. It was nothing to write him about. So we need
to... Someone will quickly point out, Kyle, sorry I had to cut you. Someone will quickly point out, you're saying it's just administrative. What about the quality of the players? Is that an issue too? Because that must be said.
That was why I said we need to buy better players. We'll have to go to the continent, look around, and get more
On the
players.
Average, the players on the domestic scene, are they good
The players on the domestic scene are okay, but they could be better. And you also need coaches who've been there, done that as well, to help to tutor these players.
Since you're mentioning players being good or not good enough, you have to remember that the best legs, as soon as they have the opportunity, they're gone. So there's no player retention, there's no quality retention. That's a major problem.
Well,
that's dealt with as well.
There are a plethora of issues around because some of these players, once they have a fairly good season,
they're off.
Before you know it, they're playing in one obscure
part
of Europe
or
in Asia.
You can't blame them.
Because of the way they're
treated. There's a whole lot of work to be done. When Enyimba were reigning on the continent, their players were at the best. They were getting cars, monies. There wasn't a distraction of, okay, we're being owed 6 months salaries in arrears. Now the players have no choice than to give their best. They even had some of the best facilities in Nigeria then. So it's a whole lot. Nigerian clubs aren't ready. And like you did say earlier, if care is not taken, we might just have our slots reduced from 2 in the CAF Champions League to 1. And one also in the Confederations Cup.
Oh, interesting. It's the end of the road for Plateau United. But some other teams will have the opportunity to progress later today in the same competition. I'm talking about the likes of Enyimba, who went to South Africa and got a 1-1 draw against Bidvesta. And so they're well placed to advance. But for Akwa United and Al Hilal, they lost on the away game. They're coming back to Uyo now. Uyo is a very good hunting ground for Akwa United, so you expect them to overturn that particular deficit. While for MFM, very interesting situation because it looks like they're just going from one issue to the other, players leaving and stuff. They lost the first leg against Joliba right in Lagos, and they go away to Mali. Let's start from there. What are your chances? I mean, how do you see this one unfolding? And what are the chances of advancing to the group stage?
Well, MFMFC, they have a big mountain to climb.
Oh, interesting. No pun intended.
No pun intended. But it's as though it's the end of the road for MFM. If they pull the result, it would be a huge surprise. But losing at home to Joliba, they have a tall order to achieve. And if at the end of the day, they don't make it to the group stage of the CAF Confederations Cup, it will have been a good learning curve for MFM. They just got into the NPFL a few seasons
just a couple
back.
Of seasons
in their
ago,
first
yeah.
season, they struggled to avoid relegation. Last season, they surprised all of us by coming second. Now they are on the continent representing Nigeria. At first, it was in the Champions League, then demoted to the Confederations Cup. By their standard, you would say they have done quite well.
But going forward, and resources available.
Going forward, they should learn from their mistakes in readiness for other encounters in the near future if they make the continent again.
I want to ask you this quickly. Which one stands a better chance, Akwa United, MFM? Because you look at MFM, I think they're in a better situation. Two things need to happen. They need to score and they need to win.
Mm-hmm.
So if somebody comes and beat you 1-0, you can go there and beat them 2-1. But for Akwa United, you need to score 3 on reply goals. And I'm sitting here thinking, I think the job is a bit easier for MFM. I don't know what you think, though.
Well, it could be. But on the road for MFM, when they played another Malian team, they surprised us.
Right.
That could be another incentive. Real Bamako, to be precise. That could be an incentive. But the edge is still with Joliba, knowing that they came on the road, defeated you.
Okay.
So your psyche takes a bashing. So MFM would need to do extra.
So Akwa stands the better chance.
Even Akwa for me, lately, they've not been doing quite well. In the NPL, they've won just one out of their last 3 home games. Now is the nest of champions. Do not forget that they lost to a certain Gambian side, Ox, at home in the preliminary round of this competition. And playing against Al Hilal, one of the best Sudanese club side, Akwa need to score 2 quick goals if they want to stand a chance. Because right about now to qualify, they'll need 3 goals unreplied. Now the question is, can they avoid conceding?
Can they stop Al Hilal from scoring?
That's the question. Akwa should score, but can they just about do the business to ensure that Al Hilal do not get to score today?
There's been some overconfidence in the air. A lot of us are not talking about Enyimba because in our minds, like, these guys will do the job.
Well, Enyimba, quite decent personnel they've got. Paul Aigbogun, not a bad coach. Maybe because Bidvest are not really the big South African club side like Mamelodi Sundowns, Kaizer Chiefs, or Orlando Pirates, but they should be cautious. If the game ends in a score draw, say 2-2,
they're out.
They
can't afford to be.
They can't. They can't.
Complacent.
So that's why I say they need to be cautious. Complacency should be avoided. We know they can do that. Yes, they've said that the gates are open at the UGS Reina Stadium, but I expect Enyimba because they look like if you look at all the 4 teams,
Plateau United like
out, Akwa United, shaky, MFM. Well, they might surprise us, but it's quite lean. Enyimba looks like the best of the teams that will get to qualify for the group stage.
Interesting. Okay. Right. We wish all the teams on the continent later today all the best. And to round off this particular segment, I'll go for Bosu. We have your tweets, and you're saying it's only prayers and a miracle that can deliver MFM from their Malian opponent. I assume that pun definitely intended in that particular situation. Let's move on quickly to the World Cup. Yeah, so we're still counting down to the World Cup, and we know Neymar, Brazil, legend. Okay, it's not a legend yet. Brazil talisman.
Legend to make
it. I don't let me get too carried away. Yeah, boy, he's a talisman. Surely, and I'm looking at him on crutches. And for me, I don't know how he's going to make this World Cup. But during this particular event, he assured our fans and everyone that cared to listen that he is on track to being fit for the World Cup. I struggle out. That's going to happen. Still got the boot on, and the World Cup is just 57 days away. I mean, what do you think about this situation? You think Neymar is just trying to calm everyone down, and he knows deep down somewhere that he has his work cut out making that Brazil's call.
Well, from the foregoing, the Brazilians they're handling the narrative quite well. You could see the tag, born a legend, attending functions, and kind of keeping the hopes
alive.
That the Brazilian will make the World Cup. I know the doctors are working around the clock to ensure that he's in good fitness shape, so to speak, towards the World Cup. He's one of the poster boys, if not the main poster boy, for the Brazilian national team.
He is.
And more like the guy trying to settle the hegemony of Messi and CR7. I'll see how fast he can cope with fitness efforts by the doctors. But I definitely want to see him at the World Cup.
We all want to see
him. I've seen one or two countries take players, not 100%, but with the hope that after one or two games, the player might. I've seen Italy do it with Fabio Cannavaro. I've seen France do it with Patrick Vieira. Sweden did it with Patrick Anderson, 2002 World Cup. Do you think Brazil would take that gamble if by June 14 he's not 100%?
Absolutely.
All right.
If he's not fully fit, they will take him because it will boost the morale of the lads.
Just
been there. There's still this argument going on that the scandalous defeat that they suffered in the hands of the Germans 7-1 was because he was missing in action.
Mm.
And in a way, he plays a huge role. And the young man has stepped up to the plate as a playmaker, as a poster boy, an influential player in the team. And the team is built around him. So even if he's not fully fit to start playing for Brazil at the World Cup, they would need him around the team just to boost morale.
Interesting. Now we'll see. We'll see how that one pans out. Eventually for Neymar Jr., the World Cup kicks off on June the 14th, but Brazil don't play until the 17th against Switzerland. So an extra couple of days there for Neymar to get fit for that opener for Brazil. Let's move on quickly to the English Premier League now. And there was action between Tottenham and Brighton. And surprisingly, that one ended 1-1. This is a minor dent to Tottenham's push for the top four spot. And this one was a surprise to some people. Brighton still not safe, so they had a lot to play for. Harry Kane scored this one, no controversy. could you argue that was an own goal? No chance.
It was
quite controversial because the ball eventually hit the Brighton and Aubameyang defender, but eventually they credited it to Harry Kane. He's been in the headlines for the wrong reasons because he so wanted to claim the goal because he's being chased or he's chasing the Egyptian Mo Salah. Harry Kane wants to equal the record of Igwe, talking about Thierry Henry, who won the Golden Boot in the Premier League some seasons back on three consecutive occasions. Recall, Harry Kane has done two and he wants to do that to make it three in a row, but I don't think he can play catch-ups with Mo Salah.
With the way Salah is playing now.
Though four goals adrift, but with the form that we've seen of Mo Salah, that young man is unstoppable. So Harry Kane should just forget it.
Forget about it. That's the message coming from Cardi to Harry Kane. I don't think Harry Kane is going to listen anyways. Let's go on this final break now. We'll come back. We'll preview the match between Manchester United and Bournemouth. And we'll also be looking at what the papers are saying.